Welcome tonight. We begin by acknowledging that we in Minnesota live on ancestral Indigenous land. Minnesota, Minnesota Makoche, is the home of the Dakota, Anishinaabe, and Ho-Chunk nations. We also know that the Indigenous experience is intertwined with our work. Immigration Court is at Fort Snelling, where our clients face deportation, sits on Bedote, the place where the Mississippi and Minnesota rivers meet, which is sacred and central to Dakota creation stories. Our clients include individuals who are Indigenous to their homelands and who now live in Minnesota. We acknowledge, respect, and honor the Native peoples whose land we live on and who are part of our communities. My name is Vina Iyer, and I'm the Executive Director of the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota. The Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota enhances opportunities for immigrants and refugees through legal representation for low-income individuals and through education and advocacy with diverse communities. We are proud to represent immigrants and refugees throughout Minnesota from offices in St. Paul, Austin, Moorhead, and Worthington. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the second installment of Perspectives, Writers on Migration. We are grateful for the sponsors who have made this event possible. Vagary Drinker, Stinson, Ballard Spar, Fredrickson and Byron, Grellin Feist, the law offices of Stephen Thal, and Seward Community Co-op. We begin the night with a few community agreements. Please set your microphone to mute. If you have questions for the speakers, please drop them in the chat and we'll get to as many as we can at the end of the program. Please listen with an open heart and mind. Tonight, we are thrilled to feature What We Hunger For, Refugee and Immigrant Stories about, that I hate about this thing. Well, I've got the, oh good, yes, thank you, Roy. What We Hunger For, Refugee and Immigrant Stories about Food and Family. Sun Yung Shin, the editor of the anthology, will be in conversation with two of the anthology's contributors, Roy G. Guzmán and Saymoukda Vongsay. We'll then have time for audience questions. And be sure to stay until the very end when we'll have a drawing to win a copy of the book. You'll need to be here to win. Our speakers are masters of the written word. Sun Yung Shin was born in Seoul, Korea during Park Chung-hee's military dictatorship and grew up in the Chicago area. She is the editor of the best-selling anthology, A Good Time for the Truth, Race in Minnesota. She is the author of several collections of poetry, which have won the Minnesota Book Award and the Asian American Literary Award. She lives in Minneapolis, where she co-directs the community organization Poetry Asylum with poet Su Hwang. Saymoukda Vongsay is a Lao American poet and playwright. Her poetry appears in journals, magazines, anthologies, and more. Her plays have been presented by the Smithsonian Asian Pacific American Center, Theater Mu, Lower Depth Theater, and other venues. She is a 2020-23 Andrew W. Mellon Foundation National Playwright in Residence. Roy G. Guzmán is the author of Catrachos, in the chapbook Restored Mural for Orlando. They are a 2019 National Endowment for the Arts Fellow and an adjunct instructor and a PhD candidate in Cultural Studies and Comparative Literature at the University of Minnesota, Twin Cities. It is now my privilege to turn this Zoom screen over to Sun Yung. Thank you.
Thank you, Vina. Thank you, Mux and Roy, for being here and being part of this project. And thank you everyone for coming to be in community with us around this set of topics with the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota. It's really special for me to be working with an immigration organization, which I may have time to dip into or not, but just to say that I'm really, really appreciative. So tonight I'm gonna ask each writer to maybe say a few words about their essay and read a few pages. And then after that, I may have some questions for them or we might go right into audience questions. So please, as Vina said, please do put questions in the chat. I will be monitoring the chat. We'd love to hear or questions or comments, thoughts, and also feel free to tell us where you're zooming in from. So Roy, do you mind going first?
Sure.
And just, yeah, saying a little bit about your piece and reading some. I would be greatly
sure. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sun Yung, for not just for inviting me to contribute to this wonderful anthology, but I also want to thank the editors, right? Everybody else who clean up my language, my sentences, made sure that I looked good. And I also want to give a shout out to the ILCM for, I think this is the second event that I've done with them in the time that I've been here in Minneapolis. In thinking about my essay, I have to be very, very frank with y'all that I am not a good cook. In fact, my partner is the one who does most of the cooking in this house. But I am a major foodie. So this means that I can very well, you know, tell the differences of different dishes based on regions, things like that, especially when it comes to Central American cuisine. And I was born in Honduras. I moved to the US when I was 9 years old, nine and a half. And I don't know if a little bit about the essay, just the form, is that many of us who have families in other countries, we most likely use apps like WhatsApp to communicate with them. And so one of my cousins makes a cameo. She goes in and out throughout the essay based on WhatsApp messages that we exchange. I don't know, Sun Yung, if you want me to read or, you know, or just.
Yeah, do you read a few pages?
Sure, okay. Okay, so my essay is titled Beans or Bullets, a Feminist Reading of Baleadas. So baleadas is essentially a tortilla dish, but there's a lot of roots. The history of it actually is tied with Indian cuisine. Naan, for instance, if you're familiar with naan, there's a heritage of that in baleadas in Honduras. And one of the books that ended up being sort of a muse in me writing this essay is this book by Omezike Natasha Tinsley. It's Ezili's Mirrors, Imagining Black Queer Genders. And it's a wonderful book about, it's a quote unquote academic book, given that it was published by Duke University Press. But what I love about this book is Tinsley uses actually different voices in order to tell this story. And I was trying to think about the different voices that that I wanted to incorporate into this book. So this is the beginning of my essay. And the epigraph is meaning somewhere between theorizing and imagining. The arrangement of ingredients inside baleadas may vary. Beans, cheese, creme fraiche, eggs, avocados, chicken, carne asada, pork, chorizo. Preparing the dish is outrageously simple, requiring a few ingredients and an urgency to consume more than one baleada. Baleadas are served at any time of day, known for their quick preparation between 3 and 5 minutes and portability. Baleadas have long been workplace staples. In the United States, flour tortillas to make baleadas can be purchased in the supermarket, in Honduras as well. But it would be an insult to the spirit of tortilla making if you relied on pre-made tortillas. A tortilla is not to be refrigerated. A tortilla is not to be wrapped in a damp sheet of paper towel and microwave, although resettlement might have taught you otherwise. A tortilla is not to be treated as an afterthought, but as the epicenter of a new world reverberating. If anything, a tortilla marks life's ephemeral nature, zooming in on a bracket of time in which the circular miracle is hot. Steam rises from within as if the earth were haunted, whispering gorgeous secrets without a care for who listens. A tortilla derives its power from the stubborn moment. It has witnessed what days look like without its presence, and nature is thrown into chaos for making such sloppy mistakes. And this is a section that begins this conversation that I have with my cousin through WhatsApp. She says, "The truth is, I've made baleadas only twice. The first time I made them, they ended up too hard. I don't know if I added enough oil or didn't let the masa sit long enough. The second time, however, I watched a video that mentioned all the ingredients, flour that you need to add a bit of salt and oil, all depending on how much masa you want to make. You don't use too much water. I made the masa, left it alone for about an hour, and then I made the tortilla on aluminum foil so it wouldn't shrink. I set the comal on the stove, and this time the baleadas came out really good, soft. I stuffed them with refried beans, eggs, mantequilla, and shredded cheese. They came out so, so good. I haven't made them since. Generally, we buy them elsewhere." And this switches to another narrative that's happening in the essay. In the myth, La Sucia's beauty and obedience are remarkable. Honeybees for eyes or fish orbiting in small typhoons. She is young, a quinceañera. Words from her mouth are proficient in siestas. Her body like azaguaros, brave new arms unfolding. If your ancestors' mouths have been hammered shut, you devise ways to communicate with them in the language of miscomprehension, intimacy in spite of the master's rules. Before she becomes La Sucia, she is just another brown-skinned promise, washes her family's clothes in a river, knows the women's work of devotion. A man from a reputable family asks for her hand in marriage. She is to be lucky. The infinitive form can sometimes be erased from a sentence and the sentence remains grammatically correct. The day of their wedding, as happens in myths, plans take a frantic turn. Because the girl is unbaptized, the priest refuses to perform any of the wedding rites. Her heartbeats feel like men going off to war. She dives into the darkest corners of depression, seizing her beauty with her. Although beauty obscured is still beauty, if it isn't objectified, it can't be an object. It can't be a subject where I come from. The could have been husband, put off by her condition, walks away, forgets her. If you stare long into a white light, what was once a rumor may cease to be a rumor. Festooned in grief, the girl refuses to take off her wedding dress. To church, to the dining room, to her bedroom, the dirty dress goes. Days pass and her skin grows darker, her eyes twist into jungles, a perfect storm transformation. One day she's told of her former lover's whereabouts. He has made a marriage proposal to another girl. The temples in her mind crumble. Owls cannot live in this darkness. She wails as if possessed by an evil spirit, primal toxin. She jumps from a cliff toward her death. And so in the rest of the essay, these three narratives of how to put together baleadas, the myth of La Sucia, and these what's up messages, they interweave. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Roy. Just such a multi-dimensional piece. And I feel like I've been waiting to read an essay by you for years now. So I feel like I just really won something really big by intruding into your already really, really busy academic and artistic life to partner with you on this project. So thank you so much. Mooks, Saymoukda, thank you. We'd love to just hear a little bit about your essay and read a little bit from it. We love it.
Thank you. You are like an essay doula, you know? This is like one of the hardest forms for me to write. And so I'm like, oh, what am I doing? I'm just word vomiting. So yeah, Roy, yeah, you're totally right. Like, you know, the editors, like they helped to just smooth things out and clarity. Let's see. So I think a little bit about me is I'm actually a former refugee. I was born in a refugee camp in Thailand. And my family came here to Minnesota, I think in 1985, just in November, and I was almost 4 years old. I was like 19 days from being 4 years old and grew up here. And so a lot of the stories that I have about childhood is from that time. What I can remember, because I don't want to forget now that I'm getting older and older, I just want to keep things like in here, like you would just want to push it back in, you know, push it back in here and push it back in here, you know? I've been, you know, my mom passed away December 2019 from cancer. And one of the things that I've been doing is I've just been writing a lot about her because I want to remember like the little things about her, like her quirks and her just things that may not feel special to other people, that may feel like every day, that may feel like, you know, little things. So this essay is about the summer that my house turned into a loud beef jerky making factory, like a mini factory. And it was great, but it was also so bittersweet because it was the summer before my mom passed away. But so thankful that I got to spend all that time with family. Whew. Okay, so I think I'd like to start somewhere in the middle. Or maybe not, that's gonna make me cry. I'm gonna start at the top, okay. The summer of loud beef jerky at Rivoli. Mom had always wanted a porch swing for the backyard patio. For a couple of days at the start of July, Akeem and I scoured the patio furniture section of St. Paul's hardware stores and their online offerings. We found the perfect porch swing, a deep red, white, black, striped patterned three-seater with matching canopy on sale for $319. It looked like a dirty candy cane, but it also looked really comfortable. And we knew that we needed that one. It was special because it was displayed on the highest scaffold in the scaffolding tower of deals. And the urgency was so real, so we bought it immediately. When we brought it home, everyone was ready to help assemble the porch swing, but really it took myself and my Aunt Rachel, who is married to my father's younger brother, to assemble it correctly. Before us, the men tried and the men did not succeed. In between putting all of the porch swings accoutrements together, we snacked on rambutans. We pierced the deep red spiky skins with the nails of our thumbs, then pulled away half of its shell. The cracked fruit reminded me of the palace banquet scene from Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, the one where guests were served decapitated monkey heads and jewel-adorned goblets. The camera pans along the length of the banquet table as one goblet of monkey head after the other is placed down in front of dinner guests. The camera stops and we see Indiana Jones' companion dressed in a sari with a tikka crowning her blonde head, a goblet in front of her. The servant lifts up the lid of the monkey skull, revealing what I imagined as a kid, silky, fleshy brains, and she faints. And the scene ends for me right there. But I always think about the dessert course in that banquet scene when I'm rotating the rambutan and biting off flesh from the seed. Sorry, I'm just getting emotional.
It's okay. Do you want to take a break? Okay. Thank you so much. And, you know, I sometimes fantasize that if we weren't in Minnesota, no one would apologize for crying when we need to cry. You know, in poetry class, I always say, like, well, if someone isn't crying by the end, like, it's not a good class. And not because I'm like a mean teacher, but because it's got to be a, you know, we try to make a safer space for actual feelings. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. Bittersweet is such a good word for a lot of this project, because we are all, you know, coming from different kinds of loss and ongoing grief as refugees and immigrants, or from refugee and immigrant families, even as we maybe finding, you know, joy and meaning and vitality here in the United States as well. I mean, all the things of life while we're alive. So one of the things that I really was excited for this book is, you know, the Twin Cities has, since I came here 29 years ago, has really gone through a foodie journey, and it's become an elevated food scene, you know, since in these intervening years. But I still wasn't seeing, you know, the everyday food ways of Black and Brown folks given the same amount of space or respect or reverence, curiosity, you know, critical thinking, that of course, you know, the, like, white chefs and white restaurateurs have had, because they've had so long to be able to establish themselves, and because of, you know, racism in the food industry as well. So there's just so much going, there's so much going on. Everything kind of crosses roads, so many roads cross in what we eat. And there's so many stories in every single dish, every single table. And I was also thinking about how one of the amazing things about food writing, you know, as a teacher, I'm always trying to get creative writing students to write in all of the senses, you know, the visual, the auditory, taste, texture, smell, and how things also feel inside the body. And food writing actually brings all these things together very naturally. Eating, cooking is such a multi-sensory experience and just engages the whole mind, body, spirit. And I'm so excited that these writers took the time to share some of their really personal, often very vulnerable stories with this broader, you know, you all, the broader audience, whoever engages with this book. So I have a question I'm going to ask Roy and Mooks, and then please do put questions or comments in the chat. Happy to, you know, yeah, address whatever we want to address. This is space for us. Yes, rambutans are lychees, mamoncillos, all of them so good. So let's see, this question is for both of you. Roy, if you want to go first, like, if you would be so kind as to talk about how your work, either as an artist or scholar or both, kind of deals with migration? Does food come into your other work, family stories? Yeah, just a little bit more about your approach to migration.
Absolutely. Yeah, you know, it's the impetus behind adding these like WhatsApp messages, right? Was to honor the fact that technology, right, in some ways has an interesting relationship to oral history. And oral history is basically the foundation of who I am. And, you know, I was rereading one of the works on testimonio today, you know, what would be called, like, I guess, like testimonial narratives, or what some people might call like autoethnography, right? Like, how does one write about oneself while also incorporating research? And I think for me, I love autoethnography. And one of the reasons why I love that is because it reminds me, and it reminds me also while I teach, that when students coming into the classroom, right, as writers, whatever, that their stories matter, right? That research can come from anywhere, basically, can come from the way that they prepare a dish. It can come from the way that they pronounce certain words. And for me, I think that when thinking about migration, migration is both personal and incredibly public, right? And it's incredibly public because migration is it's hyper surveilled, right? And because it's hyper surveilled and it's so often police, it's been so much part of the public discourse, right? Of who we are, how communities are constructed, identities, you know, how I as a Honduran relate to Mexicans, Salvadorians here, how I might relate to other, you know, immigrants. And so for me, I think that it all goes back to the oral tradition, which is why, I mean, I think that in you asking me to participate in this project, I was absolutely thinking about like, what can poetry, what can the essay form bring out of the poetry that I engage in, right? And as poets, we research all the time, right? I research all the time. And again, not just like in these sort of like public official archives, but also in these archives that, you know, are based on silence, archives that are based on why does my mom cook this way? Why is it that my dad cooks this way, right? My stepdad is Cuban. And I think about that a lot. Like, why, you know, why was my mom in the kitchen this day versus my stepdad? What did my stepdad do to my mom's cuisine and vice versa, right? So yeah, I was thinking about these sort of connections with your question, Sun Yung.
Sorry, having malfunctions. Yeah, Mooks, I mean, you're one of your stage names is Refugee Genius. And wondering if you would talk a little bit about your migration and what it means to you as an artist and writer.
I think movement has been a major theme, like, across a lot of my work. And, you know, I'm a poet and I try to do prose, and I'm a playwright, and I also do performance art, but I only perform as myself, or like a version of myself, because I'm not trained. So that's my excuse to like not be good, but having fun still. And that's what matters to me. I don't care about the product, about the process, baby. Like, that's what I always say. But I think, yeah, the themes of like of movement and connections, like you say, Roy, is like so important. I feel like food, I have this term that I created to like have a better understanding of my identity. You know, a few years back, I came this term of motherland orphan, right? Somebody like me who considers himself point motherland. I was not born there. I was born somewhere else, but I'm tethered to motherland by food, stories, music, art, language, you know, and then the people that's like in my life, the faces in my life. And food for me is, it's also how I connect to other people. I think the way that people present you food or the food that's presented to you can say so much about how someone welcomes you into their world or try and get rid of you. So, I think we talked earlier about how, Roy, you said that you're not so great of a cook, but you're a good eater. And I feel like I'm the same way. Like I make Lao food and it looks like Lao food, right? Like it passes if we were to just make a cookbook and just took photos and Instagrammed it, but it wouldn't taste like it. And so I wouldn't want someone to think that I wouldn't love them as deeply because my food don't taste right, you know? Okay, I'm just bibling now, so. But thank you for the support earlier on. You're right, I shouldn't apologize when I cry. I should just let it happen and just.
Thank you. Yeah, I think just because I'm older than you, I get to just be a little bit bossy about that.
Yeah, I consider you my baby elder.
Yeah, totally. I feel like I've graduated to junior elder. Like I, you know, like in, yeah, 5 years ago I was baby elder. Now it's like, no, actually, like, I'm hitting the puberty of elderliness. Could be ugly, could be rocky, folks. So just, you know, that's a warning. Thank you, Ty and Vina, for your questions. The seed for this book. Oh, Roy, what are you gonna say?
No, go ahead.
The seed for this book was really Diane Wilson's essay at the end of A Good Time for the Truth. Look at me, I'm selling the press's books. And Diane Wilson, who's Dakota, who I'm sure many of you know and love because also she has a brand new-ish novel called The Seed Keeper, which is incredible. And she's just an incredible person and activist and has beautiful other memoirs. Memoirs, this is her first novel. And it really, her essay, you have to read it, but it is about seeds and seed keeping and the land as our teacher and Dakota traditions and health and working with Dakota and Native youth and how many of the Native youth that she has worked with over the years. She used to be the co-director of Dream of Wild Health farm. And, you know, she says in her essay that many of the Native children did not know that food grew out of the ground, let alone kind of about the traditions of corn or, you know, the specific kind of types of Native food that have sustained the Dakota for thousands of years and or the Ojibwe for thousands, if not tens of thousands of years in this region. And so that and just general other workers in food justice, the food justice movement, like LaDonna Redmond, I got to work with a little bit several years ago, and then just starting to read more about food writing, more writers of color, more chefs of color that I mentioned in the anthology who could bring their whole selves to this work around food. And also didn't need to only talk about their ancestral cuisines, that they were very proud of their ancestral cuisines and made dishes in those ancestral cuisines, but they of course are more than just tokens for, you know, white exoticism, fetishization of, I haven't said that word in a while. I am getting old. Fetishization of our food and of our cultures and of our aesthetics, of our homelands, traditions. So, you know, cultural appropriation is also a big part of kind of, you know, a counter story motivation for this. But also I just really, I learned coming to Minnesota, especially with all these, you know, spending a lot of time with Southeast Asians, like the hospitality is just off the whatever item you want to call it, like chain, hook, etc. The hospitality of, just most traditional peoples is so much deeper than anything I'd experienced, in the white American world. And is definitely a part of my homeland's culture as well, Korean culture. So I wanted to honor that. I wanted to bring stories together. I wanted to see what, you know, we had in common. I wanted to see kind of where our wounds are and what do we need to do to take care of ourselves and each other? What kinds of wisdom do we want to pass on to the next generation? So those are all motivations. Book. Yeah, thank you. Yes, so Roy has mentioned the book Grace Cho's Haunting the Korean Diaspora, Shame, Secrecy, and the Forgotten War. And Grace and I met in 2007 because we went on a trip to Korea together with a group of Korean diasporic, Korean American activists working on solidarity with Korean people, reunification, democracy movements, queer issues and advocacy, sex workers, rights and support. And, her book that just came out, Tastes Like War, which Sue has mentioned, which I have blurbed, is incredible. It's an incredible story, personal. Please check it out. Yes, so, you know, she and I were in Korea together with this group, and, she has a Korean mother and a white father, and didn't really speak very much Korean, and I'm a Korean adoptee and didn't speak very much Korean. And so we were kind of like the outliers in that group. There were a lot of the other people were children of Korean immigrants, and most of them were like either kitchen fluent or fluent in Korean, you know? So we had translators and everything, and it was my third trip back to Korea, but it was still just, we were getting access to political prisoners and just people who I wouldn't have met as, you know, kind of a tourist. And just politics, that food is political, it's deeply political. I mean, like everything, but that, you know, especially in Minnesota, it hasn't been treated that way by the white media. It's been treated as, you know, maybe an ethnic tradition or a source of pleasure, a source of community, but not, we haven't been looking here at food justice issues in the mainstream, the food apartheid going on in our neighborhoods, industrial food systems, all of those things, climate change. Like, I just want everything to be together all the time. I just feel like everything is related. And so that's my impetus for, you know, kind of doing anything. One other thing I'll say in response to Roy's piece about they're using the word feminist in the title. You know, one of the food stories that has stayed with me for a long time since I was 13 years old. It didn't make it into the introduction, but you know, when I went back to Korea for the first time, and I noticed with horror, I was like a little baby, you know, raging feminist already, and I noticed with horror that at the homestay, the Korean mother would, she and the daughter would make all the food in the kitchen and then serve us and the father and the brother and then eat in the kitchen after everyone was done. They didn't even come out to the main table. I was really horrified. And then, you know, upon some reflection, I realized like that wasn't that different from my American house. Like, we were all at the table, my brother and I and my dad, but my mom never sat down. She was cooking, she was serving, you know, we had like a tiny kitchen. The kitchen was right, you know, the table was right next to the stove, right next to the refrigerator, right next to the sink. There was just basically a little path you could walk around. And she was just up the entire time, you know, and my dad didn't lift a finger, you know, before, during, or after. So that was that in terms of like women's labor, and then just thinking about labor in general, you know, so much of food writing has really been like bourgeois, or a domain of the upper class, who can get other people to cook for them and clean for them and do everything for them. And they get to focus on beauty and pleasure, right? So it's like, I wanted our voices forefront. I have tons of food stories about how racialized our food systems and our eating systems are in this country, as we all do. And I just thought, I want to see us talking about those things here in the Twin Cities, in Minnesota, and yeah, learning from each other. So that is some of the passion behind the project. Any other questions for Mooks or Roy, or comments, points of connection? The book has not been out for very long, so many of you probably haven't read it cover to cover yet, but I know that you will. Vina, did you have any other questions from an immigrant law perspective?
There's a question from Emily.
Oh, Emily, I'm sorry, missed it. Thank you. I didn't really answer Ty's question. I'm sorry. So Ty's question, how we came to the decision to use food as the vessel for these stories. I actually, you know, I kind of answered it, but also after this book, which came out in April 2016, which we were up to the very last minute adding the names of Black people who had been killed by police in the introduction, and that we still need books like this, activism, revolutionary love today as well. Not that we thought the problems were gonna be solved in 5 years after, you know, 400, 500 years of colonialism and genocide and slavery, but after this book, you know, I thought, I want to do another anthology. I'm somewhat still obsessed with Minnesota, and both how many wonderful, amazing, powerful people are here, you know, and how racist it is. I mean, I don't think it's a coincidence. It's kind of a crucible. You have to really, exert yourself as a person of color here to maintain maintain any sense of sanity, any sort of, you know, kind of boundaries, psychic boundaries. It's like a continuous job. So I wanted to do a book that was a little bit more about joy, or had more space for joy, had more space for regeneration. I mean, I think A Good Time for the Truth has that too, and that people's pieces are about, you know, their life experiences. But yeah, I wanted to do that. I wanted to have more joy. I wanted to, honor what I was seeing in my community. Like, because any meeting you have with people of color, there's gonna be good food. And you just can't say that about white meetings. You know, if you have a white meeting, you might have like hummus and celery. I mean, things, white people might be getting in better in Minnesota, like catching on, right? But at a people of color meeting or event, like, there is gonna be music, there is gonna be good food, there is gonna be, you know, more warmth. There's gonna be more kind of sense of interdependence. It's gonna be less transactional. I mean, it's just white supremacy culture, you know, that occupies a lot of our spaces. So I wanted a book that could maybe take us into some of those, you know, joy and pleasure spaces a little bit more. Yeah, thank you. So So Emily, did I miss your question? Are you, oh yeah, Roy, Saymoukda, how did you each choose which stories to share in the book? Great question, thank you.
You wanna go first, Saymoukda, or should I go first? that is a very good question, actually. So there's a lot, one thing that a lot of people, specifically in the US, take for granted about Latin America, right, is how Latin America has just people from everywhere, right? You have the Japanese traditions in the South, you have the, the Jewish, the Palestinian traditions, the Arab traditions. You also have, in Honduras, you have basically our culture is essentially like, it's an Afro-Caribbean culture. Even though we have sort of the indigenous sort of dishes that we share with, you know, El Salvador, Mexico, Guatemala, you know, with the tortillas, right? Thinking about tacos, thinking about pupusas, for instance. A lot of our food is actually very much Afro-Caribbean. And so one of the things that I had originally thought about was talking about plantains, specifically about how plantain dishes appear, how they're done in Honduras, versus other places. And then I thought, you know what? That is a project that's gonna take me like a longer time to sort of research, right? Because, you know, Honduras was basically the site of so many banana plantations, right? And so having to balance that with the fact, you know, that I'm like here talking about like what is so distinct and similar about plantain dishes as opposed to, you know, plantain dishes in Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, you know, the rest of the Caribbean, I was like, this is too much for me right now. So that's an idea that I had to put aside. And then another idea had to do with beef. The issue is that I don't eat beef. And the more that I thought about it, I was like, you know what? This doesn't feel true to me. And I don't know how I can write a whole essay about beef and make it sound delicious, even though yeah. So those were two ideas I had.
Beef is delicious, especially if it's in Slim Jim form. Just kidding. I'm not kidding. I love Slim Jim. I'm sorry, were you done? I was just thinking about Slim Jim. It's okay. Sun Yung, I don't remember what I pitched to you before when you invited me to.
I think it was about rambutans, mostly, or that's what that's a memory that I have, but.
Or something like tropical fruits or something.
Yeah, tropical fruits. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you necessarily knew you were going to write about your mother.
No.
First. Okay.
Initially thinking about the tropical fruits that are being trucked up from Florida to this shop called Most Tropical Fruit Store, and it's in Maplewood. And it's recently opened. It's been open like a few years now. But every now and then there's like a couple of big semi trucks that bring in these tropical fruits from Asia, from Florida to Minnesota, and they sell them pretty cheaply. Like you can get like a whole box of like 5 pounds of rambutan for like $15, right? And this was just like mind blowing because when we were growing up, you know, just like a handful would already cost like $20. And so it was such a luxury and like a treasure to like have these little, you know, monkey brain rambutans. But I think also I chose the beef jerky ultimately because I went to open the chest freezer and I just was trying to find ice cream for myself and hiding in the basement trying to eat it from Rasan, my three-year-old, and I saw leftover were just a couple of freezer bags of beef jerky left. And the reason that my mom wanted us to make lots of beef jerky was because she wanted to make sure that my dad had Lao food after she was gone. Mm. And we thought that it was because she was craving beef jerky. We're like, why is this woman craving beef jerky so much? Like, what a weirdo. But that was just like her way of taking care of us. And I just was like, okay, I need to write this story so that maybe my son could appreciate this. So
That's
why I chose that.
That's really beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, you too. I mean, I could just listen to you forever, actually. My heart is very full. And so is the clock, says. I don't want to keep anyone after beyond our committed time. And there's a drawing. So those of you who have made it to the end may get a book. So I'm going to turn it back over to Vina. Thank you.
Thanks so much to all three of you. It's just been such an amazingly inspirational and mouth-watering evening. So I'm excited to make some beef jerky this weekend. I'm gonna turn it over now actually to Rudy Rodriguez, our wonderful board chair, to close us out and do a little drawing.
All right, thank you everyone. And it's been a pleasure here, and just stay tuned, just brief remarks and then get into the book giveaway of What We Hunger For. So as chair for the Immigrant Law Center, I just want to provide my sincere and heartfelt thanks to our amazing authors and our sponsors. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed the conversation. And I'm thankful for everyone that was able to join today and for your continued support of the important work of the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota. While I know many of us are happy with the promise of a new administration to advance important work on immigration, we all know that there's so much more work to do, right? And I ask for your support to help us with this important work. So for example, we continue to see an increase in the number of people applying for DACA. And ultimately we know there's a strong need to support our immigrant communities and continue our important advocacy work. And all of your support really helps us to provide quality legal assistance on a wide variety of immigration issues. So you have an opportunity to donate, and I appreciate for all of those that you were able to attend. So, and we had the link so where you can donate. So please, if you can, open up your hearts and your wallet to give to ILCM. And we appreciate that. So you will be getting that book. And thank you so much. And Vina, I'll hand it back to you.
Thanks so much, everyone. This was just a wonderful evening. We are so thankful to everybody for being here tonight. So thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.